a free call from an inmate at the Lebanon Correctional Facility. To accept this free call, press 0. To refuse this call,
so it's a free call. It's
going to
be a short call.
And is subject
like 5 minutes. Normally it's 15. So
thank
we'll
you for
have
using
to
GPL.
Have him call back again. Delmas Colvin, good morning.
Greetings, my friend. Greetings.
How are you?
Cold morning.
How are you this morning?
I'm great.
You're great. Now, so first of all, this is the debut episode, episode number one of the Delmas and Daisy show. And you and I are going to chat once or twice a month. And you're going to tell us what prison is like and what your life is like and what's it like to be incarcerated in a high security prison in Ohio. But way before that, first of all, it's 7 a.m. Nobody really knows that by watching the video. It's 7 a.m. here. And why does Delmas Colvin call at 7 a.m.? What time do you get up and why?
I'm usually up at 5:30. I've been getting up early ever since I was in grade school, basically junior high school, because at home I had to get up, feed the cows, and then shower and get ready for school. So getting up 5:30, 5 o'clock is, I've been doing this ever since I was around about 14 years old. So it just comes natural now.
So you just get up early. Now, when you get up that early in prison, is it quiet? I mean, are most of the inmates sleep in?
Yeah, mostly it's real quiet. You're in your cell, you know, and counts don't clear around about 6:35. And when count clear, I am a diabetic. I go to the infirmary, 6:35, take my little insulin shot and come back to the block just like now. He just popped the doors for everybody else. See, I'm on range 3. I am considered a level 2 inmate because it's supposed to have been a mentor program before the COVID kicked in. How I got chosen, hell, who knows? But I have a single man cell, so, you know, and 8-block life is, you know, prison is what you really make it. You got to be able to, you know, to change, you know.
So you are in a single man cell, and
yes,
are you locked in at night?
Oh, yes. Every 9 o'clock, everybody locked in.
So 9 p.m. at night, from 9 p.m. at night till 6:30 in the morning, you're locked in.
You're locked in the cell. I have a television. I have magazines. You know, I usually read something good on. I might watch it, but, hell, I'm usually asleep by 8 o'clock. I don't stay up late.
So you'll be in bed early, and then you wake up early.
Yes, I do. That's the thing. You know, I also have during the week, Monday through Friday, I work in OPI. It's called Ohio Penal Industrial. We have 3 different shops. We have a tag shop, which make metal tags. Mm-hmm. We have a distribution center, which will distribute, get the shipping and receiving. I work in a place where we make the temporary tags for vehicles, cars, boats, and motorcycles. You know, the little stickers mm-hmm. that you put on your tag? Yes, but that's about to come to an end. Because the DMV don't get their own 3M machine. But,
oh.
You know, yes.
So let's start from the beginning, Delmas. What does a large black man who's in prison for multiple murders have in common with a not-so-large white man who is a criminal profiler and assists law enforcement to track down and arrest serial killers? You know, people would like... Look at it. Well, first of all, our first meeting, the first time we exchanged letters, didn't go so well. When Delmas normally responds to people, he pretty much tells them to kind of go screw themselves. And I sent a letter back. I believe you have a better memory than me, but I kind of said, you know, basically, who you think you're talking to?
Yes.
And
yes.
Tell us about that.
This was the first one. Yes. Oh. See, this one. What people never say was. You know, you got the worst end of it because, man, I was taking it on the chin before you came along. You have no idea of some of the damn letters I got. You know, mm-hmm. It's been promises, 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 and when I tell them what I need out of this, it never. It was like when I said I need, it's like they never heard that. They just heard. All they was to worry about was me. We're going to interview you, you know. Maybe your story could help others, this and that. It was always that. And everybody would profit from it but me. And I was like, yeah, man, this ain't capitalism. This is more like, you know.
So you kind of pretty much told me to go screw myself. And then I sent a letter back. And did that surprise you that I came back?
Right. I was I was harsh because I had, you know, you got to weed them out if you don't. Oh my God! But you came back with the letter. I said, man, this guy actually got some spine. I'm shocked, you know, because no one never wrote me back like that. Never. What was that?
Who do you think you're talking to, Mr. Colvin?
Yeah, I said, well, hell, but he's from the Cleveland area, so I said, okay, he got some spine, you know what I mean? Then, after that, then when you show up to visit, I was nervous as hell, and after that, man, it was downhill. I said, you proved to be, not only a worthy adversary, turned out to be just a decent human being, considering some of the mail I've been getting. I used to write them back telling them it was masquerading as human beings.
Right.
Know? A lot of them didn't like that. You know, I was like, the one pretended to be a woman that was selling my letters, having them auction on the internet. That day, that bearded face son of a bitch. That motherfucker, I couldn't believe that.
So you and I have become friends. It's strange. Yes. It's really strange bedfellows. You and I we've become friends. And at first it was business. At first it was business, and then we got to know each other. We're both from Ohio. Yes. We both like sports. We really get along well, and we help each other out. And you know, it's a little business, and we also are friends. So.
Yes, it is.
We came to visit you, and the visit went great, and Wendy was there, right.
It was great. Well, Wendy, she was the key, because all the COs kept, they knew, that was the first visit I ever had.
Okay.
People don't understand. That was the only visit I ever had. Usually I get visitors from law enforcement, and it's not in the visiting room either. It's in the conference room.
Right.
And all the COs was coming back there looking at me and saying, man, there's this gorgeous lady out here wanting to see you. I said, oh, man. I said, thanks for telling me. Now I'm really nervous.
This beautiful blonde is waiting
and all of man, and these COs, they were looking out because they got little people.
Oh my gosh, that's so funny.
They got little people that were looking out. Say, man, I said, oh, what are y'all doing? I said, oh, man, she's gorgeous. I said, who is she? I said, I don't know. I mean, what you mean?
What you mean you don't know?
These people just show up to see you out the blue. I said, yeah. But no one believes me.
That's so funny.
I know these people. I said, this is the first story. You talking about strange. Strange bets.
Strange
between me, you, and Wendy. Oh my God, we make the odd couple look like the Brady Bunch.
The call is originating from an Ohio correctional facility and may be recorded and monitored.
And Wendy jokes when we go to death row, I chat with the inmates, so you and I are talking, and she's the death row chef. She goes and, you know, she makes wings and she makes heats up your sandwiches and all that. Isn't that funny?
All that.
Wow. So it's been a long time, and I just want to say a shout out to Ron and Surviving Life. Ron is, I have a producer that's producing this channel, and he's from Scotland, and he's doing a really great job. Okay. Yeah, he's from Scotland, man. So this is our first episode ever of Delmas and Days, and I thought it'd be kind of fun because a lot of people want to know what prison's like, and they're intrigued by your story, but they also want to know how my 10-week-old deaf boxer puppy's doing. So I thought this would be a good mix, right? Just a little bit more of a lighter interview. All my interviews are so damn heavy. This would be a little lighter interview. So let me ask you Delmas, I want you to respond quickly to just a rash of questions. Just respond quick. You had COVID. How was it like, and how do you feel today?
Scary. Jesus Christ. Man, you haven't... You ever tried being so weak you can barely stand up? Imagine putting something in your mouth and you cannot taste it. It's scary.
That's pretty scary.
I'm scared. And plus, you hear on the news about all the deaths. Just in January alone, over 90,000 people have died from this.
You have 1 minute remaining.
So go ahead and finish up the COVID thing, and then we'll take you'll call right back, okay?
Yeah. And I went to the hospital, and man, and they gave me that resume, the same thing they gave President Trump. I was one of the first. They actually put me on a clinical study, and day two, I was walking the hallway. I was finally getting my strength back, and I looked in this one room. It had four inmates, all the inmates on one tier. Mm-hmm. They had four inmates in there, man. All you can hear is that damn ventilator, and the nurse said only 50% will only make it.
Whoa.
That was scary. That's
so
scary.
How do you feel today? Do you feel normal?
Oh, I feel great. I feel great. I mean, ooh-wee.
All right, call me back and let's continue. Thank you. So what happens in prison, this is all inside here, because of COVID, they're giving inmates free phone calls. So Delmas and a lot of inmates, almost all of them get free calls, but those free calls are only 5 minutes. And if you don't make those calls, you lose them. So he'll call, when I'm interviewing them, they'll call, it might be 5 minutes, the call will drop. He may get another free call. Sometimes they get two or three or four a month. And then it goes to the real calls that I pay for, all the calls that I deal with inmates. I pay for those, and there's about 15-minute calls. So as soon as he calls, you'll hear when an inmate's calling you. It either says, this is a free call. That means it's going to be a short one, and I'm not paying for it. Or it's going to say, you know, Delmas Colvin or whatever. We're going to get into some things in the holidays with him when he calls here. We're going to get into his commissary. We're going to get into his cell. What's his mattress like? So let's listen what this says this time. Listen.
Hello. This is a prepaid debit call.
So that's prepaid. So that's a regular call. Okay. If you want to write Delmas Colvin, it's Lebanon Correctional Facility.
Correctional Facility.
LECI is the call.
To accept this call, press 0. Thank you for using GTL.
If you want to write Delmas Colvin, it's Lebanon Correctional Facility, LECI, Box 56. Lebanon, Ohio, 45036. But you have to put his name in prison ID. It's Delmas, D-E-L-L-M-U-S, Colvin, C-O-L-V-I-N. And Delmas, what's your prison number?
536-490.
536-490. So if you don't put Delmas Colvin in the prison ID, it'll come back to you. So if you want to write Delmas Colvin, welcome your letter. So Delmas, let's dive into some deep stuff here. Again, I'm going to throw you some, and you're going to rattle off answers quickly. We talked about COVID. How were the holidays in prison? What's the holiday? What's Christmas like in prison? What's the food like? Anything special? Do you have a Christmas tree in your cell? Stuff like that.
A Christmas tree? My God. We don't even have lights. And in Lebanon, Christmas, man, this is one of the worst days, because it used to be years ago one of the best meals, but we got Airmark as our food provider. Man, it's the worst meal ever. It sucks.
So the food's not good there, even on holidays.
Oh my God, it sucks. And you go at lunchtime, you go during the afternoon, and they give you a bag dinner. And the bag dinner consists of peanut butter and jelly sandwich, Lay's chips, and a fruit. But the meal itself is horrible.
Okay. Wow.
That roast beef is like the roast beef is like leather. Everything here is, the food here, it's terrible.
So basically you're surviving mostly on chips, peanut butter and jelly sandwiches, and a little bit of fruit.
Yeah, stuff in commissary, you know, like Jack Mac crackers, you know, you can make. But, you know, every now and then we'll get a decent meal. Like this whole weekend, it sucked. But yesterday we had fish, baked fish. It's one of the decent ones.
Okay. So Delmas, when you go to commissary, what do you buy?
I buy chicken breasts in a pouch. It's $2.30. I like chicken. I buy a bunch of chicken breasts. I buy crackers. I buy Jack Mac's, the fish, sardines, stuff like that.
What about coffee? How do you get a coffee in the morning?
I don't drink coffee. We got a microwave right there. A lot of guys got hot pots and they sell. I have one too.
Okay.
It heats up water.
So you could if you wanted, but you don't drink coffee.
No, I don't drink coffee.
Okay.
I wake up in the morning, I drink cappuccino, some cocoa. I just plug my hot pot in and, you know.
Okay.
Some water.
Cappuccino or cocoa. That's interesting.
Yeah.
So talk about your cell. Some people have cellmates. You don't. You have your own cell. I suppose it has is it a bunk bed or a single bed? Do you have a desk, a toilet? Tell us about your cell.
It has a bunk bed, and it is small. It's around about 1, 2, 4 by, I'm going to say, they say supposed to be 4 by 9, but hell no, it's a small cell.
Okay.
I can stand in the middle and touch both sides of the wall.
Okay.
It's around about 9 feet in length. The toilet sits by the door. You have a window with a screen, and it was open, and it's road. This is an old ass prison.
You can see outside.
And yes, through the screen. Yes, it's old. It's raggedy, and it's roach and rat. It's infested.
Do you have your own toilet?
Yes, that you do. You have your own toilet, and, you know, they got a and then leather end. It's three ranges. It's 40 cells on each range.
Okay.
And at the end of every range, you have a shower. And the shower's three in, three out. They got dividers here.
Okay.
They just put them in within the last year and a half. And at first, oh, my, it was wide open. I mean, in the shower, it was like fuck a fight.
Whoa. Now, how about you sleep on the bottom bunk?
Oh, yes, of course.
And what's your mattress like? Is it comfortable?
Hell no, nothing comfortable. But, you know, so there's, like, if a guy get into a fight, go to the hole, we'll steal his mattress, cut it, take the stuffing out and stuff it in our own mattress, or we, you know, try to get one, another one to have two, you know.
Gotcha.
There's things going, like, you know, the guy that works down there, give him a coffee or two, and he'll put extra stuffing in it.
Oh,
you know.
Okay.
It's just like on the street, things, you know, you could make it. You can make comfortability, and, you know, a bag of coffee by anything from a mattress to a shot of ass.
Oh,
if you're into that, I'm just saying.
Whoa,
you know, that's why I deal in coffees. You know, coffee's like,
wow,
it's money here.
Coffee's like money.
Yes.
So tell me, one time you were showering before you had dividers, and another inmate said another inmate made a really weird comment about your ass. Tell us about that.
This was back when the day when Lebanon was rough. I mean, when it was before the cameras for showers, 3 and 3 hours showering, and I was, you know, I was just rinsing off. So I was about to step out, and the guy said, "Man, you got soap all in your crack of your ass." So that told me two things. I said, this motherfucker, first of all, this son of a bitch checking out my backside. And second of all, he must think I'm some type of fuck boy. So I went to my cell, and I got dressed and put my boots on. Came back and tore that ass up. I stumped the shit out of it. They put me in a hole for around about 4 months. Charged me with assault, too. He was naked. I stumped him every place I could. I didn't care. Back then, we had Timberlands.
Whoa.
And that was strictly for fighting. I tried to kill him, and I did not care. They charged me with assault and everything. Outside cases, I got two consecutive life sentences. You think I'm worried about a fucking assault charge? They slapped me on the wrist. And
you also recently got a card that was pretty offensive, and we'll put this in the video, a Krampus card. If anybody knows about Krampus, it's like a black demon figure that has children in a sack and chasing children. And you took offense to that.
Oh, Belschnickel has traveled from distant lands to discover how all the boys and the girls have been behaving this last year. Oh, too much strudel.
Hey, that son of a bitch, that mother was Mike Ritz, that motherfucker. I don't know this guy. He just sent me that. And the first thing I noticed was the black guy with the tail, the horns, the red tongue hanging out with a little white girl. He got a basket on his back, and the little white girl is in the basket. She's petrified, and all the other kids around him running, trying to get away.
That's the worst card you could ever send, Delmas Colvin.
It is. And I'm a thick-skinned guy. I mean, I've been called the worst by the worst. Don't bother me one fucking bit. But that goddamn card irked me to death. I'm like, oh no, this fucker implying I'm a pedophile and this and these. And when I roll him back and cuss him out, he told me he just sent it to other people and they wasn't offended. I don't care, but it put me in a real foul mood.
No, tell him about the letter you sent him. That it was really funny. What did you tell him when you sent him a letter?
I told him how fucking stupid was to send me that racist ass car. And I told him, when I get out of here, once paroled, I will make it my business to come down there, and I'm going to kill everything in the whole house. You, the kids, the wife. I told him, hell, I'm even going to pull up the flowers when I leave.
Was he? Oh my gosh, can you imagine getting that letter? He doesn't know you're not going to get paroled.
Yeah, he has no idea.
Got him!
Hey, Wendy, bring in Daisy. So Daisy's going to make her debut here. Wendy just sent you a prank. Wendy just sent you some magazines, and she decided to... Tell us about the prank Wendy pulled on you.
She sent me a magazine, a Women's Day. Mm-hmm. I took it in good stride. I actually read it, too. And we talked about... I did like that recipe, though, because I can cook. I used to be a good cook on the outside. I can cook. But and people was looking at me like, so I gave it to, we got one punk in the block. I gave it to him.
Oh my gosh.
Happy as hell.
So she's saying like Women's Day, good housekeeping, right?
I ain't got that one yet. I got the Women's Day.
So we have, this is Daisy on camera now, Delmas. I'm holding her up here. She is a 10-week-old boxer, and she's a female, and she's deaf. And Delmas, the first time I told you that, you laughed because you thought it was a joke. I said, we're going to train her with hand signals.
Yeah.
Right?
Oh my God.
And we're going to train her with sign language. And you said, oh, you laughed. And you said, no, this guy's serious, right?
First time I heard of a deaf dog. I even never knew they exist.
Yeah, so 20% of white boxers are deaf. And she is, you know, at first we're like, ooh, this could be a challenge. But listen, Delmas, she sits, she lays, she shakes already.
She's just about
housebroken. But we have a little problem. I'm going to let you hear this, Delmas. Your co-host here has some anger issues.
Sounds great.
I will rule over you all, foolish humans. This world and all of its tasty nug-nugs will be mine. Also, who needs hearing when you have fucking mind bullets? We do not forgive. We do not forget. Expect us.
Do you hear that? She got some anger issues.
Yes,
she likes to fight.
Don't we all?
But she's doing good. She's healthy. She has four stages. She either sleeps a lot. She goes to the bathroom. She eats. She loves food, Delmas. She eats.
Yeah.
Any time of the day. Last night she had her first Dairy Queen ice cream. She loved it.
Oh wow! Okay.
And then
a good life.
she'll be a little bit cuddly sometimes, but most of the time it's what she's doing right now, chewing on my finger. She's aggressive and she likes to play. Right? Have you ever had a puppy?
Yeah. Yes, I had a dog. Raised him from a puppy, trained him and everything.
You did. Yeah. A lot of people would say serial killers kill animals growing up, and that was not true with you, right?
Never. I back in the day, I hunted small game, quail, duck, rabbit. But we ate them, but never. The puppy that I had, the Rottweiler I had trained, he used to watch the little kids when my nephews came over. Wouldn't let you in the backyard to play. Love that dog. Oh, love it. Never. I have never harmed an animal. Never. People, you know, that's a misconception. Well, maybe he tortured. No, I did. Max, oh my God. Great watchdog.
His name was Max? His name was Max?
Max, yeah.
Max.
My nephews from Columbus used to come down. Well, I call them my nephews, really. And there'd be a bunch of kids in the backyard playing. I had a tent back there and everything. And the mothers would come pick up their kids. They'd go to the back. He wouldn't even let them in the fence. He didn't know you.
So Delmas, you and I'll be we'll be chatting you know, a couple times a month, and from today, you know, the next couple weeks, you just kind of observe what's going on in prison and keep us posted on life in prison, other inmates, maybe the kind of mail you get or the calls or emails you get.
Yeah.
And we'll keep them posted on how Daisy's doing, and I'm sure in the next few months she's going to be big. We need to get her to be able to stay in a crate. That's what we're working on now, and totally housebroken. But we will be in touch with you, and I know you and I talk at least every week, and
yes.
Anything else you'd like to say to the audience? Well, or do you welcome letters?
Yes, I'm going to tell them the best about that court. As far as it goes, the worst thing can happen if you catch this shit in prison. Because, man, they talking about social distancing. It ain't, and the health care here is not great, but I had the most problem when I came out the hospital. They put you in isolation for 14 days. There ain't no fans up there. No, it's hot as hell. That did the most damage to me.
But oh, wow.
Being sick in prison is man, you're in a fight for your life because the health care system here, It's not that good. They give you a Tylenol and send you back to the goddamn block. Just this year alone, four people have died here.
Wow.
Two guys died in their own cell. The one guy had a heart attack right in the fucking day room, and it wasn't even a CO around. It was out in the hallway talking. Had a heart attack right in the fucking day room, and now he's in critical care right in this block here.
Wow.
We yelling for him, and they don't care. Right in the middle of the fucking day room. and the nurse had to come bring you back doing CPR and everything. I'm sitting there looking. I said, he ain't gonna make it.
And one of the COs you like died of COVID.
Died. Yes. He worked down there in our shop. He worked at the metal detector where we walked through. Mm-hmm. He was fine Monday. We talked to him Monday. Man, come Wednesday, he was dead.
My goodness. Well, Delmas, do you welcome letters?
Yes, I do.
Okay. You have 1 minute remaining.
So, sometimes the prison guards use me for things that go against my warranty.
If anybody wants to write Delmas Colvin, we have the address.
Feel free.
Yeah, we have the address. You can also email him on jpay.com. And I can send photos to him on jpay. So if you want to send photos to Delmas, you can. And hey, man, episode one is in the books. And thanks again to Ron for surviving life, for producing this thing. And we look forward to talking to you in a couple weeks.
Okay. People take care.
Have a great... Oh, wait, one more thing. Who's going to win the Super Bowl?
Tampa Bay. Come on now.
Oh, I was going to bet you 10 little Debbies that it was Tampa Bay, but you're on board with me.
Tampa Bay. I got a lot of money on it, too. I got around about $60 on it.
All right, let's talk Monday. Hopefully we'll be celebrating because I got some money all on right. Tampa Bay, too.
Yes, sir.
All right, buddy. Take care.
Later.
Bye. Episode one is in the wrap. It's a wrap. It's in the books. Delmas and Daisy Show. There you go. If you have any questions that you would like me to ask Delmas Colvin on this show, throw them in the comments. Make sure you like, comment, subscribe to our page. Hit the bell so you get notifications. I'm going to be interviewing serial killers and covering all kinds of crime. And we would like to ask any question you have of Delmas Colvin. We'll ask it on the video. Thanks so much for listening in. God bless y'all. Be safe.